Welcome back. In the previous tutorial, we learned how to programmatically connect a MIDI instrument, like a digital piano or synthesizer, to the computer, get it to report on some of its particulars, and wrote code to send some MIDI messages to the device. Today, we are going to extend our program with a couple of new features. We are going to write a program segment that will enable us to play music using the computer keyboard. By music, I don't mean a piano concerto, just that in our program we will respond to key presses on the computer keyboard and send note on and note off messages to the MIDI device. The other thing we are going to do is to set up a two-way roundabout communication pathway between the computer and the MIDI device. Our program will listen to incoming MIDI messages and will be able to send those messages back to the MIDI device, either unaltered or altered in some way. An example might be changing the pitch or send the message to another MIDI channel or channels. Last time the program I wrote was a console application. But from now on, we will need to have an event-driven graphical user interface. So to create a new project for today's tutorial, either select WPF application with .NET Core or WPF app using .NET framework. It doesn't really matter which one. I personally use the .NET Core one. As a matter of fact, you can even go with the Windows Forms app, except your interface will then look and work differently than mine. My UI is very simple. There is nothing much to say about it. The important thing is to add some event handlers. One for a key down press, one for a key up, and just one more for when the window is closing. But first, let's look at the constructor of the main window class. This is where the application starts. The initialize component method was created for us automatically, and this is where the user interface with its controls is built. The rest is similar to what we had last time. If you missed the first video, please watch it. MIDI in and out device objects are created and added to these lists. And then I am just looping through the lists, and if I find the device I'm interested in, which in my case is a Roland FP-30 digital piano, then I open it. Importantly, my input device now has a field to reference the output device. I will need this for the two-way communication I talked about earlier. I also have these two variables for the input and output device at the class level, because I will have to be able to reference those devices in the event handlers. So let's look at those event handlers. When a key is pressed on the computer keyboard, I first check if this key is one of those keys I designated to act like a piano key. Then a so-called MIDI musical note is created, which is basically a MIDI message that will instruct the MIDI device to start playing a sound. We will look at how that MIDI message is created a little later. As you can see, the way I designed this application, it is the MIDI musical note object's job to actually send that message to the MIDI out device. The name of that method is beginPlay. When the key is released on the computer keyboard, our program has to find the note that is currently playing. Once found, The endplay function is called on that note, and it sends a message to the device to stop sounding that note. Now, you probably wonder, what is this MIDI musical note pool is doing here? What I do here is that when a key is pressed, I put the corresponding musical note into a buffer, and when the key is released, I retrieve that note from the buffer. And when I no longer need it, I free it up from the buffer. Now, what are the parameters? The first one is the MIDI channel number, which for now is arbitrarily 0. The second is the musical note number. I have a dictionary here that maps keyboard keys to musical notes. The third parameter is the octave. So if the note was a C, then this would be middle C on the piano keyboard. The last parameter is the velocity. Now let's look at the MIDI musical notes pool class. It is a static class with static functions. There is no need to create objects of this. The buffer is an array that holds up to 4 musical note objects. In the enlist MIDI musical note method, I look for a vacant slot, and if there is one, the properties of the MIDI musical note are set, and the MIDI musical note is returned to the caller. The retrieve musical note function simply does what the name suggests. The key here is the note number. In delist musical note, the note is removed from the pool. In practical terms, its note number is set to 0. It is not really deleted. What is the point in having a pool like this? Well, this way we don't have to create a new musical note object every time a key is pressed and then have it garbage collected when the key is released. That would be bad for performance and an inconsiderate use of memory. Now, on to the MIDI musical note class. Much of it was already explained in the previous video. The default constructor comes handy when the pool is created and the note is initially set to 0. The parameterized constructor assigns values to the fields of the object. The beginPlay and endPlay methods, I believe, were covered in the previous tutorial. Last but not least, we need to deal with the issue of sending those MIDI messages back to the device that we received from it. This is done in the MIDI in message handler callback function. This is now different from last time. We are only interested in data type messages. Here I am dissecting the message and breaking it down into its constituent parts. If it turns out to be a note on or note off message, then I am simply sending it back to the device. I leave it to you to think of and implement one or two interesting alterations to the message before passing it back. By the way, in future tutorials, we will do a number of crazy things here. Oh, one more thing I almost forgot to mention is that in order to be able to receive MIDI note on and note off messages from the device, we need to tell it to start sending. So after the device is opened, we have to call the MIDI in start function. Now let's compile and run the program. The sound comes out of these speakers. To test the round trip, I need to break the piano's internal pathway from the keys to the sound generator. In the Roland, it is called local off, and the hotkey is function F sharp. Now it is silent. But when I run the program, I create a connection from the piano to the computer and back to the sound generator of the piano. So now I can produce sound. This is it for today. Next week I will cover sound selection. That is, the program will display a whole lot of sounds to choose from, and we will be able to change the built-in voices on the MIDI instrument remotely.